Hello. We are back. Welcome. Just gonna do the usual sound check here. And I've got Gonzo, by the way, on audio with me on this fine day. Loud and clear. Thank you kindly, Gonzo. Awesome. Excuse me. So, we're here. The less than regular stream, back as usual, though. Episode 3, Gonzo on audio at present. I think Sector was maybe going to join. I invited Bronick and everybody else, of course, too. But could be a little louder. Okay. Uh-huh. I turned down my thing because I thought it was too loud. I erred on the side of caution. Here we go. Check. Just a little bit louder. How's that? A little bit better, maybe? Wouldn't be the stream without our obligatory...
Yeah, that's better.
Awesome. Gonzo, okay, welcome. Perfect. So let's just jump right into the very first thing we want to talk about, which is the website update that we just kicked out that you all, and you in particular, had a big part in. Let's go here to the website changelog. And so, pretty, maybe I'll crank myself up just a little bit more. I noticed myself getting into the yellow there on the... on the EQ. Also, it's a little dark in my office. Let me pull the blind. I cranked myself up a little bit, Gonzo. Let me know how that goes. The battle with audio continues. We're setting us to save us.
Sounds good.
All right, excellent. Excuse me. So, last night, local here in the USA... we put out 6.6.0, and a big change here was updating the final, as it says here, final steps page of each mod list to provide better information. And we'll take a closer look at that in just a moment, but that's pretty huge because it's really like, it's a matter of some of the lists were presenting you with things that maybe you didn't really need to care about until the end, you know, and you needed the context of where you were to use them, right? Like the nav mesh generator delta plugin, you need to have all your stuff in order before you really get there. So anyways, the verbose section of the user's guide to be a better companion to the build. Okay, so yeah, we're talking about the quick start, which is also very new. I've noted to Gonzo actually before we went live, there's a bunch of stuff we, you know, came out with in the past month since I've started streaming less. That is just, uncovered on the show yet, so maybe we'll go into that, but one of those things indeed is the bullet list overview, aka the quick start. Mod list page tweak, kind of, that most people probably won't notice, but it will keep the consistency, you know, a little bit better. So anyways, let's take a look, shall we, at the final steps of good old iHeart. And so, doesn't apply to this one, actually. I'm not going to go there. Okay. So what we have here is a more complete kind of rundown of the various things that concern you when you're reaching the end of the setup process, right? If you haven't been doing it as you go along, this would be the time to go here, get your config, validate it. Using the tooling that we have available, or some other tooling of your choosing, if you got something like that available. And then, yeah, the home stretch kind of stuff, right? Delta plugin, light fixes, nav mesh cache, technically optional, but decent to do in advance, depending on your hardware. And then run the game. So this is a much more complete compared to what was there, which was kind of a very high level, you know, less direct. So excellent job on this. I had almost no, by the way, involvement in this update. Just the team, present company included, was awesome at, you know, recognizing these things needed a fixing up, which is great. Let's go back now here to my changelog. And the section that we talked about there. So we have quick start would be, you know, it's a new change to the website workflow where you have a start here button that actually takes you to a place that is probably the best place, the most concentrated, complete place to get info of what to do to use the website. Start here, boom. Just 10 steps to get you going. And then, of course, Gonzo is referring to, in the changelog, this section here. Gonzo or whomever wrote it, sorry. And yeah, just, I'm not going to go into the detail here. Please, you know, come here and read it and give us feedback. But it's quite a bit to read, but I feel like our intention, and correct me if I'm wrong, Gonzo, is that when you're coming to the website for the first time and you're wanting to get set up, but you want to be like, okay, I want to be sure I'm doing the right thing, this page basically is it.
That's it. Yep. And then the eventual video will be a perfect companion to this, where if you want to just watch it in video form, you can.
Yeah, that's right. I suppose it's appropriate to hype up. Let's put this in here. Check out the change log, and also we'll hype up Gonzo's video. Occurred to me the last two episodes, I wasn't doing a good job of like keeping track of the outline, and then when I put things on YouTube, it's like, well, I don't remember what we did. Sorry about that. We'll do a better job today. But yeah, let's hype up a little bit Gonzo's video, which is, I will just say, an opus, if you will. But it's the video form of using the website and just done exquisitely. So very hyped and looking forward to that. Any kind of teaser we want to share with that about that right now, Gonzo?
I mean, really, the 6.6.0, the update, like it was kind of a teeing off point to clean up the rest of the script, and I'm going to start recording lines for the video and recording more footage of the website, the new updates to the website. And hopefully it'll be up. I don't want to give an ETA, but I'm hoping sometime in May.
That's exciting. That's really exciting. Thank you for all your work on that. Definitely looking forward to it. I've seen a little bit of the work thus far, and it's just good stuff. Can I talk about the fast motion total overhaul? Because that was just totally crazy.
Please.
Yeah. So Gonzo has recorded doing the entire total overhaul and has edited a clip of the entire thing, but like sped up such that, yeah, it wraps up in like, I don't know, what was it, like handful of minutes, right?
You could show it off if you'd like.
Oh yeah, I would like. Let's do that. I would very much like. We'll just get a link here.
But yeah, that's going to be a more longer term project, I think, is getting the, because I do want that to be available, the whole 5 hour video of me doing the thing, the entire total overhaul. But you know, I would kind of like to commentate a little bit over it at the very least, just kind of explain what's going on in the install. And so that could take a while.
Well, I'm down. If you want to share a link, I'm definitely down to put it on and have you commentate away. That would be lovely. Excellent. Excellent. Thank you for that, Gonzo. All right. Gonna download it to my local first, so it doesn't.
So, if anybody wants to see what installing Total Overhaul looks like,
yeah, it's just unbelievable to witness. And yeah, I'm downloading it to my local so it doesn't lag out. Let's go ahead and what do we call this? Magnified speed sped up.
Yeah, I can't remember. I remember I extended it to 5 minutes, so it's actually Total Overhaul in 5 minutes is what it is.
Okay.
I want to say it's like somewhere around 60 times speed.
We'll do it at double. I'll put it on faster, even. So yeah, but we'll pause my. And this is it, folks. This is the no. Come on. All right, fine. VLC, I hate you too. I won't go full screen.
So I'm going to use a clip of this when talking about installing the mod list, and I'll hype it up and, you know, invite people to watch it in case they want to watch a 5-hour video of me talking about installing Total Overhaul.
Very exciting. This alone is great. I'm very happy I'm playing again at 1.5 speed here, but we're just showing the whole clip.
Look at me fly now. There were a couple of mods in here that I realized I had forgotten some of the downloads on Nexus, so I had to actually download some stuff.
Okay, right on. Yeah, I had the same thing happen to me when I was updating my, you know, setup, which again has bit rotted. Ooh, look at that. Command prompt, just flying by.
Welcome, Spoke a Tide Pod.
Welcome, welcome. We're just installing, I don't know, 500 mods in 5 minutes. That's all. Caught us at the last minute here. Yeah, I'll say. Ooh, look at that. Red text. That's the game. Okay, wow.
Oh yeah, showing all the errors.
So, Santa will send you... Oh, okay, welcome. Welcome, welcome. That's awesome. Well, welcome to the Morrowind appreciation stream, right? Something like that. So that was, just to fill you in, that was our website that we have here. You know, we've got mod lists for Morrowind with OpenMW, and we just went through 500 plus mods sped up fast motion in like 5 minutes. Eltario, welcome, glad you're here. We just showed Gonzo's fast motion Total Overhaul clip, which I believe you've seen. Very awesome stuff. So yeah, let's check that off. And I wanted to go over a few other things that we have done since I kind of slowed down streaming that are out there. One of the, I think, the neatest things we've done is the MOMW Update Center, which is where you go to see what's been updated and when, right? And we've got updates going all the way back, like, basically forever ago, 2 years ago there. Wow. And as recently just as last night as we just went over this update here. So MOMW Update Center, you can find a link to on basically all of our GitLab mod links. And there's also a link to it. I know I stuffed it. Here we go. Mod Update Center. What's new? You can find the Update Center right here. Just click that button and here you are. And observant viewers might also notice there's a click here to see dev updates. And doing so takes you here, where you can in fact see dev updates. And this would be the same, basically the same mods as the other page, but ordered not by release, but by like what's been going on, right? Development wise, unreleased changes, that kind of a thing. And major props to Settiness for helping with the, you know, the UI here. It's basically his brainchild. So yeah, I just made the JavaScript yell less. Yeah, so Update Center. Next up though, since we're here,
Steady's good at really designing these things.
You know, it's I don't want to show without him being here, but like some of the work he's done on modding OpenMW UI like updates is just mind-blowingly good. It's so exciting. But yeah, so one of the things when I've not been streaming and just being a human in general, one of the things I've been doing is creating new Lua mods. And one of the newest, in my opinion, one of the neatest ones I've worked on in a while is Go Home, which, as it says on the tin, gives NPCs a schedule in that they will go home at night or during bad weather, which is highly configurable, including those aspects. It's another take on the old NPC schedules mod that's been around for some time, except it optionally and by default will, excuse me, will, for NPCs in an area, it will look at all the doors that are around and try to be like, oh, okay, this is Fargoth's home. I get it. So that's how I can say at nighttime, okay, Fargoth's walking around like a fool. It's nighttime, time to go home and be a fool at home. And we do that. I'll show you here in a moment. But that's basically a kind of a look into the guts of how that works. Okay. Playing the game. All right. You know what I need to do? Hang on. I need to lower my settings a little bit. We need to go into streaming mode, which is to say potato mode. I'm gonna go ahead and actually crank that up a little more. That too. Just turning down the visual settings so that it runs less potato-y, hopefully. But we'll take a look at basically what happens in Sedanine with Beautiful Cities of Morrowind loaded. It turns out actually all the NPCs in Sedanine have a home with BCOM. And indeed, in cities like Balmora, NPCs like Hul actually have a home too. A lot of people, not all of course, but a lot of people in Balmora have a home with the waterfront stuff. All right, here, let's slow down a little bit. Whoop. Okay. All right. So here we are, just in good old Sedanine. Pay no attention to this fellow right here with the fancy pants. But these folks are your regular NPCs you know and love if you played the game. And so what we're going to do is we're just going to instigate. go home, right? How do we do that? Ooh, okay. Ah, very interesting. Smoke a Tide Pod. That's very interesting. So you're playing on the Android version, which is... if I didn't have a Steam Deck, I would be totally into that. That's totally cool. Let's make it nighttime. Here we go. And this might be hard to see. But what happens now is, by default, there's a slight random delay that happens, but after up to 30 seconds. But after that, with a random, by the way, very rare, 1 in 50 chance that they will wait even longer, I think up to 5 real-life minutes. But there goes Fargoth right now. Here comes Eldefire. No home. My home is the tavern. No, but seriously, a future feature would be to say, well, for, you know, cretins like Johnny Hostile, which would be the aforementioned Fancy Pants fellow there, maybe they will go to the tavern, or they will go to the, to, you know, the House of Earthly Delights or whatever. And so, anywho, let's go ahead and just look the other way so that I can casually disappear myself. Ba-bum, there we go. And so, oh no, am I not? So there's a NPCs without a home, such as this fella. Oh, okay. Wow, interesting. I wonder... The multiplayer, nice. I would love to get back into multiplayer, honestly. It's such a beautiful thing. But as I was saying, NPCs without a home, such as this fella here, they simply get disabled, which is to say disappeared, if you're not familiar with engine terminology, at nighttime. Just like the old school mod used to do. But there is code that says don't do it while the player's looking at them. We have actually two options for that. One is a viewport check, where I check to see, are you within the viewport? So you could be behind the lighthouse, but still in my viewport, and I wouldn't disable you. Or we also have a rendering raycast check, which let's just go in here and turn that one on. I have it off by default because it's kind of expensive computationally wise, but maybe a modern computer wouldn't notice. But you can come down here in the script settings menu, and you can say, use a rendering raycast to disable, and just tick yes there. And then it will be, you know, if the tree blocks you and I, it'll disable him. But I think he has tripped the chance to not get disabled. You see, merchants have a slightly higher chance to stay up all night. We like to party. So let's go ahead and just bring him out. Welcome. And here we go. And then they go back to their normal business. He walks there and... goes back to, so talking in engine parlance, he goes back to his normal AI package, which is what's called Wander. Only NPCs, by the way, that have the Wander AI package are affected. As you might guess, if you didn't know for sure, Wander is what simply makes the NPCs wander around. See this fool right here in the fancy pants just wandering everywhere? That's because I put Wander with a certain distance and so on, several different options on there. So, that's go home in a nutshell. And the nice thing about doing it in Lua, again, allows me to do kind of wacky things like finding doors, sending them home at night. I can support mods like Tamra Rebuilt or anything else. And I can be very choosy about what I affect by this kind of schedule rotation without like breaking the game in not hilarious ways. So yeah, go home. Thank you for my go home TED Talk. For watching my go-home TED Talk. The next is in our kind of wham-bam.
Amazing-looking mod. I can't wait.
Thank you, Gonzo. And if I can just, if I will just quickly take a moment and appreciate that, because this is like one of those mods I find like when I play the game, I get more ideas of what I want to work on to fix the game. And certainly go-home and the next one we're going to look at, Bound Balance, were ideas I had while playing the game, and I thought, you know, I just thought, But looking at some of the planned features I have here, I noted in a shower thought, we could have NPC-specific schedules. Maybe some NPCs just are out at night and go home during the day. You know, like that's a thing that could happen, right? At a high level, I would like to change the code of the mod to be like a general scheduling engine. Right now, it's very opinionated about doing the very specific go-home thing, but I could... you know, make it a scheduling engine. That's just work. It'll happen, maybe. Pre-2090, I don't know. Yeah, it might have been Detail Devil who came up with this idea for the door knocking mechanic, where NPCs that go home, and this ties into the next mechanic actually, will lock the door, and then there would be some kind of a disposition check, a door knocking animation, a sound, maybe some dialogue. And, you know, that would be a way to, like, gracefully get into the confines of an NPC, right? Like, ooh, Eltariel, thank you so much. I haven't played Daggerfall still. Got to get on that DF Unity bandwagon. But that's interesting. Cool. I will for sure. So this is something that I definitely want to do. Going to do door locking first, though. Businesses lock up at night, that kind of a thing. As I mentioned previously, NPCs without a home would go somewhere. I don't know. Somebody on Discord mentioned, like, maybe, and this is further to the previous idea of being, like, a general scheduling engine versus a just strictly go-home thing. Maybe NPCs could go to the merchant or whatever in the afternoon, or, you know, this ties into that kind of idea and is way more complicated, but it's certainly something I want to do. Another kind of a wild idea I had was NPCs that are normally inside could maybe come out during the day, you know, and like just have a normal schedule, because there's quite a few NPCs in all of the towns that are just like stuck inside. And maybe it makes sense for them to be inside and we wouldn't want to touch them. That's why the mod has code to ignore NPCs as needed, but certainly not all of them, right? So it would be kind of cool. I had kind of a thought of, hey, Santa, welcome, my man. Kind of had the thought of like, oh, well, should NPCs go in for a blizzard? Because I don't know right now if they do. I'm about to look at the code, but I'll hold off. But then somebody on Discord again, I think it was Erm, and a few other people were talking about, well, maybe, you know, Nords with frost resistance, literal frost resistance, wouldn't care about a blizzard, but like an Argonian probably would, you know. They would be like, eh, get me out of here. So yeah, quite a few planned features. Thank you, Gonzo. I appreciate that. It's a labor of love. Moving on, though. The next one is that, as I mentioned, I kind of came up with this idea. We're just having a party here. Morrowind party. I mean, what better way to, you know, spend your Sunday, right? So another one, as I said, I came up with this idea. And credit goes to some of the awesome bound weapon mods that are already out there that also inspired me, but I always wanted a way to basically say, okay, spoiler alert, by the way, if you aren't familiar with Morrowind, this is like a spoiler into the mechanics, but basically, if you played some Elder Scrolls game, you're going to know what I'm talking about, Skyrim or Oblivion, but the bound weapons spells provide arguably some of the best weapons in the entire game, and you can get them within the first half hour of playing pretty easily, and they can be like the only weapons you really ever need for the whole game, which, you know, I think is kind of lame a little. And so that's the point of this mod, bound balance. I don't claim to be like the, you know, the Todd of balance or anything, but we did, and by we I mean, you know, myself, Eltariel, Gonzo, Sophie, take an honest attempt at thinking like, okay, well, so what we do is how it works. Let's just take a look at how it works here. We detect when the player casts a bound weapon spell, which you can see happening here. And then we just kind of whoosh, we swap it in real time for a changed thing. So what's going on here is you might not recognize that axe because my character has no skill in conjuration whatsoever. And you can't read the text there because it's small. But I am getting a ruined bound axe, which is significantly weaker than the godly one you get, the toddly one you get by default in the game. So yeah, not strictly trying to make bound weapons useless, because if you have a high conjuration skill, you can get these weapons to be more powerful than the vanilla ones even, you know. There is an option to limit the power, of course. But yeah, so it's not strictly intended to just cheese them, uncheese them, rather. But, you know, just to make conjuration kind of a little more rewarding to go after. So, yeah, anyway, bound balance, recently rewritten by me, 2.0. And next up is, you might be familiar with our patches, which we're going to look at next. But what we have done is we have a dedicated project by our own Sophie, and this is where we house a lot of our kind of our community, but certainly also our project upscales and things of that nature. So yeah, it's a Skooma Sweetshoppe, and it's a mainstay on our list because we're just putting content on here as we need it and as we cook it up. So it's yeah, it's going to be the new home for that kind of a stuff, that kind of a thing. Mostly like patches and stuff, but like meshes, textures, things like that, we're keeping here. And where they had previously lived with MOMW patches, a lot of Sophie's work. And so on that note, we have MOMW patches, which has graduated out of a beta status. We were kind of like Gmail. We stayed in beta for a little while. And yeah, this is just your, you know, your repository for smaller patches like plug-in replacers, that kind of a thing, mostly cooked up by Ronick. But certainly contributed to by basically all of us on the team. And so not exactly new if you're familiar with our older patch collections. But this is, yeah, we're just always kicking new stuff out here for sure. So it's the companion piece to Sophie's Sweetshoppe to bring you the patching goodness. So really the thing I wanted to do today, though, was implement an idea further to that. I think MOMW patches is a good leaving off place there, because one of the things that we wanted to do, and I'm going to go ahead and resume my voices of the live stream. There we go. We have this, you know, this very excellent collection of patches, more so this one than Sophie's, in terms of being replaceable by Lua, though. You know, Sophie's work, we cannot, you can't really, like, fix textures with Lua. I don't know, that would be kind of amazing, but, yeah, we can't really do that. So we're always going to need to have this kind of warehouse of normal map fixation. But MOMW patches is something that I think over time we can phase out or simplify vastly down to a Lua script. And once OpenMW 0.49 launches, it's going to be a thing. Indeed, I wanted to begin making it a thing today, though. So we're going to start doing that, and I'm going to... We'll start by picking on Fargoth, as is tradition, but the high-level idea is it's a Lua mod, number one. Number two, it's just one plugin that you install and you never have to change. That's important, because we don't want people to have to change their load order or whatever if we add new patches. Number three, further to that, we have the actual patches delivered in the form of YAML data. I know. But here's what it would kind of look like. And some of the things we would do, not everything, are covered here. For example, disabling. We're going to disable Fargoth's house. We're going to move his front door. But we might do, I don't know, any other number of things that we're currently covering with a special patch here. You know, something like this one, I think, for example, will move something. I'm not going to highlight the spoiler. But yeah, I'm almost certainly it's like something in a cave, you know, gets moved. And we could do this with Lua in kind of like a magical way that wouldn't require a separate plugin. And again, we can just like, oh yeah, here... install this extra data file. You know, you already got the mod installed. Just chuck this into the data folder or whatever, and it would just work. So we're going to build that today, or begin building it, I guess. So let's get there. There we go.
And so the idea is generally to cut down on the amount of patches in that list and replace what we can with just like an all-in-one Lua fixer.
That's right. There's a lot of churn on the mod list for various reasons. Number one, because mods are just always updating, but that's a problem I can live with. And by the way, yes, it does just work, Smoke a Tide Pod. But a number two source of churn is like, from our end, when we have a new patch for whatever reason, that's a change to the load order and whatever. And when we're doing it with Lua, we have a lot more flexibility to do it in a less intrusive way. And credit goes to Altariel for coming up or kind of driving the concept of doing it in a way with that's undisruptive to the user without needing a plugin change or all that. So yeah, I know I started doing this. Okay. So okay. Yeah, I like just started doing this and did very little else. So at a high level, moving things around, changing them in the direct way that we're going to want to do is needs to be done strictly in a global script in OpenMW Lua terms. So I have a global script here, and for now we're just adding interface commands that I'm going to run in the console in game. So a few things have to happen. We have to read in the data file, which have I, let's see, did I go ahead and create that? Okay, so I actually haven't created the data. So this is a point of discussion where we have to make a decision here. And I'm just going to make a folder here called data. And that's officially where they're going to live. For now, I'm just going to have one file called test, and we'll go from there. We don't have to decide, you know, the future fate of all data, but for now, just test.yaml or ML, because typing less is good. All right. Okay. So as I have here, I guess, let's go ahead and action. Let's start out by just, because the first step is we have to read this into stuff that we can use in Lua. The whole idea of reading from YAML is well and good, but it doesn't, well, you know, happen on its own. It doesn't just work. We got to make it just work. So, Sable, I religiously, admittedly, superstitiously quote strings when I work with YAML, and you should too. Just saying. And so the idea here is I'm setting the coordinates of the thing that I want to disable. We're going to tell the script there's a thing that's at this XYZ position. This is the record ID. The script finds it. And if it does, turns it off. It just works. So we'll just put 1234 there since we don't really know Fargoth's house position yet. 7. And I'm leaving those unquoted because they're numbers. Maybe. I don't know. We'll see. Alright. That's all I need for now. Well. Now I need to figure out how to actually do this whole read the YAML into Lua thing. Thankfully, our friends over on the OpenMW team have implemented this here module. And this OpenMW markup package, as it says here, allows to work with markup languages. There's explicit support for decoding and loading YAML. I think JSON would probably work. But I didn't test it, and we're not going to test it today, I don't think. Maybe we will. I don't know. So I'm going to go ahead and let's just put this here. All right. So I think this is, we were discussing on Discord the various things that we might need to do whatever it is we want to do, and this was like some of the potential fields, but I'm not going to worry too much about that just yet. So, we're going to need markup, and we're also going to need, interesting, Altariel, thank you. That's interesting. I just wonder if that's something that would be explicitly the same every time in every setup, but maybe I'm just ignorant about that. We're going to need VFS package to read our YAML file. Interesting. Okay. That's great. Maybe it's something that could change potentially in an ESP update. Right? All right. So we're going to do... Yeah, always does. Okay, so maybe on ESPs that are like ancient and we know are never going to change, that's a good option without having to know the coordinate. All right, so first off, we're going to say test. So we'll just say YAML. Okay. I think that's all we need to just open the file, and then we will, so that gives us the file handle, right? That's this thing that I named YAML. And so now we can just say lines, right? So this is just a very, very rudimentary sanity check. We're not really doing anything meaningful here yet, of course. Just making sure that I'm not crazy. Not too crazy. Okay. I think that's enough. Yeah, that's enough to fire up the game over. Here we go. Okey-doke. So we want to go here to Lua. Lua G. Patch. Excuse me. And let's get the console, the terminal here in view. That's where it's going to put the noise. Helps if I have the mod loaded. So let's go ahead and do that. Okay. There we go. Am I even loading my mod? Hold up. Here we go. Okay. Oh, sheesh. The answer is no. No, I'm not. What do you mean? Well, here's the thing. What I'm actually loading is this one. Which we have, we have this defined here. I'm just gonna go ahead and there we go. Ooh. Interesting. This is the way to do it. Okay, okay. So we have YAML lines. Like that. And it's just line. You don't need a semicolon, silly docs. That's what happens when you got C programmers writing Lua, am I right? Oh, okay. We actually don't need to restart OpenMW. We can just reload all Lua scripts. Get back into our LuaG context. There we go. It blends. Look, this is the YAML data. We are successfully taking the random text file I put into the folder. This thing here. Just all this, and it's being read and spat out by my Lua code into the console. Success! Okay. But we want to actually use it. So, how do we do that? Ship it. Yeah, yes, that's it. It just works. So yeah, we're gonna do this paths with prefix probably thing to slurp up just all random YAML files. In that folder, we'll have to graduate it beyond data test, but yeah. No, just trying to see, like, what is our... So now, what is our API with this? I was sort of hoping we would get, like, a Lua object back, but that doesn't seem to be the case. Okay. Well... Let's try this. Let's just try printing seek out. Yeah. I will like, I'll have it, because I think it's an iterator. I think it, each time I call the interface function, it will give me a little more, maybe. We'll see. Not doing what I thought it would do. Oh, because I'm not telling it. When. Set. Okay. Read. Read. Okay. File reading implementation details that I'm not normally used to dealing with. That's okay. Current position. Set pointer to the beginning. Okay. Let's do that then. Hmm. This will put me at the beginning every time, so let's go ahead and just put a bunch of, whoops. Put a bunch of, let's just seek in there a bunch. We'll seek, and then we'll... Whence, so... Is it a no? It's a string. I don't really know how it's supposed to work. Lua file handle. Minus the IO business here. That's more or less what we're doing. We're not direct. We don't have a access to this part of Lua in OpenMW, but that's what the markup package more or less does. We'll have changed. Yeah, this is what I was expecting. At the start of the file. Okay. So then I want read at this point. I see. So maybe I don't need VFS. I need to just take a step back and sanity check myself here. I don't need VFS for this at all. This is interesting. Because that's straight JSON right there. Let's just do this. Let's just load the file with YAML and forget about everything. Yeah, see? Okay. Let's just do that. Markup load YAML. Away, VFS. I don't need you. Okay. Apparently just doing that will print one, or this will print one, because we're reading. So, let's open up my file. Now we're getting closer to what I wanted to do. Let's just print the whole file and see what happens. Just a table. Good, good, good. That's good. So can I this maybe? That would be so. That might blow up. I would be fine with it. Mildly. Yeah, that's it. That's what I wanted. Look at that. I wrote disable there. I read the code here. And now it says boom, disable there. That's it. Wonderful. Just wonderful. Okay. So let's pretend, so let's move beyond that a little bit. For data. This is not a file handle we're working with. We can do normal for loopy things with it. I think we're closer to doing the thing here now. I just want to do this one more sanity check here. Fargoth's house will be moved. Yeah, there we go. That's what I'm looking for right here. The word disable and 1, 2, 3, 4, again, come from this over here. I'm reading it in the code and just spitting it out this way. So, again, the idea is we have some basic code that is agnostic to the input that just does some things. And then we define the inputs here in a somewhat simple text format that can be easily updated in a transparent way to the user. All right, I like it. Ship it. So let's go by ref ID here, as El Tariel noted. And let's get ourselves a ref ID for Fargoth's house. Get out of our Lua context. Type the right thing. And we have here ref num is this one right here. All right. So interestingly, yeah. We can get that. So I'm trying to think out loud now how this actually will work. Might be more helpful to look at the documentation for game object. Because unfortunately, what we lack here is a query-like system, like what we use for the website to say, you know, give me mods with this or that criteria. They planned on doing something like that and had to scrap the feature. But, oh, geez, it sounded awesome. Okay. We want GameObject. Here we go. So now we need to go from we know a ref num, we know a record ID, we know this, that, the other thing. We know all this. Now how do we, like, do something to that via Lua? That's where we need to get to next. So let's look. Okay. We need something that's going to give us one of these or more. Game object, yeah. Okay. That's not good. So we're going to need to, we're looking at a, so one of the approach that I wanted to take for this was, instead of when the game loads up, we zap all our changes in everywhere, what we would do instead is we would use the on object active handler to do it when the player loads the area. It occurs to me that that approach may, and depending on what we would ever change, it may end up with, like, distant statics that look weird, so we would need to maybe factor that. Yay, scope creep. So anyway, though, that's right, so we're going to do it on object active. Let's just do that, so let's move away from my stupid hacky interface here. Now let's graduate to real code that might resemble what we actually want to use, okay. Let's get on object activate in here. Okay. And just for fun, let's go ahead and look at the engine handler's reference page. This one, on object active. Object becomes active. This is a bit of a concise explanation, but on object active happens every time the object becomes active. So like when I load up Sadanine and start a new game, those objects are active. When I walk away to the other side of the map and I come back, non-object active. They're becoming active. So it happens each time, and it would be sufficient for what we need. And what we'll do is we'll keep track of the things we've affected so we don't do it more than once. All right. Okay. Thus the code begins. Okay, so we get, as you may have noted here, we get one thing from the handler, which is the object we're talking about. All right. So going back here to my documentation, where game object was. Interesting. Oh, cool. Okay. I didn't really realize that that would work for Morrowind ref IDs, but it sure does. Cool. That's awesome. Good catch. Yeah. Thank you, Eltariel. Appreciate that. Ooh, that's awesome. Okay. Let's load up core. Okay. So let's get that ref num. Stick it in here, the real one. Content file. Just leave all this stuff here. Doesn't matter, we're not going to use it. Excuse me? Why is my editor really, really bad? Oh, I have an unbalanced thing somewhere, I think maybe. Yeah, I sure do. Here we go. Let's just erase all, not all of it. Here we go. Not sure why this is still mad. Might just be my language server geeking out, as it is wont to do. Yeah, there we go. I won't complain. All right. So we need that markup code that I deleted already. Load YAML. Okay, so what we're going to do is we're going to do the aforementioned thing that Eltariel mentioned, although get ref, get form ID, which this is a part of the API new for 0.49. I've not messed with it yet. Form ID being something specific to later games, but obviously still usable for Morrowind. So ref, we want content ID, content file here, right? Yeah. Thing. And so this gives us just a string. That's weird. That's wrong. It's got to be wrong because here it says obj. Yeah, that's got to be an error in the documentation. I'm gonna hope it is. Okay, Okay, interesting. I want to see what this does. just out of morbid curiosity, what the hell even is that? Oh, no, I killed that already. I just have to unpause the game. Interesting. Okay, so this is actually the... I actually do want my handler back. Or my interface function back. I know. And we probably do have to restart the engine since we're adding, removing handlers and all that. We've got to just start fresh. Okay. I see you there, red text. I was trying to get away with being lazy. You can't have an interface, by the way, without an interface name. We're going to be MLP for now. MOMW Lua Patcher. And if indeed... yeah, here we go. So, okay, I was actually failing to read the full thing here. This is going to give me text. Let's, engine already done. Fix a typo. And do the right thing that the code says. We'll do the nearby way, actually. We're going to do the world way, rather, since we're already in the global context. But I'm going to paste this in here and comment it out. And then maybe we can try. Because we can always send an event to the player if it makes more sense to do it that way. I think since we're already in a global context, this is fine. Okay. Here's the thing. This Lua language server, I tell you. It thinks everything's broken randomly when it's not. All right, here we go. I don't know if it does that in VS Code. I assume it does. I assume it's not an Emacs problem. Okay. Hiya. What? Oh, right. I changed the name of the interface. MLP. Patch. There we go. Okay. Yeah. All right. Cool. It just works. That's it. That's Fargo's house. Now, what's next? We'll do what we came to do. That's right. This is how Todd really intended. Okay. Look at that. We just patched Fargoth into homelessness. Cool. That's really cool. Good find on the form ID stuff, Altariel. This greatly simplifies retrieving the things we want to affect. Really makes that a lot easier. Otherwise, we would have to write, like, in on object active, we would have to, you know, check the position and all that. Wow, cool. Haha. So our Fargoth's house remover function is good. Okay, so ideally what we would have here is we would have like some, so let's so we'll basically have like a map here where we will say yeah, for sure. No reason we can't support that too. Yeah. Cuz I could see like if RefNum being a little annoying for stuff that updates a lot. It's gonna be that easy, I think. Okay. So rather than hard coding in disable, now I'm saying we're gonna do the thing that we say we wanna do in the data file. Remember this whole thing? And again, we're saying action is disable. So can we, let's back out of the game. No, I've already done that. Okay, good. We'll build Fargoth's house back up again. And now I wanna just do the thing. I don't care what we're doing. I'm just going to do it, right? Yeah. Okay. Maybe it looks something like this. Oh, thank you. Smoke a Tide Pod. You're too kind. Thank you so much. We're just hacking on the game. Like, we're into the guts of the game, making it bend to our will. But to give you some context about why I would want to delete a house in the game, I realize maybe that doesn't make a lot of sense. What we do on moddingopenmw.com is we tie 500 mods plus together and we make them work. Believe it or not, most things don't totally 100% work together out of the box, and it requires some massaging, right? And we have a lot of different mods that we have made ourselves to move a tree here or a wheel there. So things look right, you know, because, I mean, I'm sure you've played a modded game and, like, you've seen, like, the tree growing in a building or something like that, you know? It's just inevitable when you combined content that was never explicitly intended. Thank you. So, yeah, anyway, that's what I'm just working on, a more Telvanni way of doing this. All right, so here we go. So this is what my action-agnostic code looks like, right? Is it going to just work? Will it blend? Let's see. But that was my vision. Is to just have, like, we just say easily in text what we want to do, and then we have a magical mod that do it for us. And we no longer have overlapping mushrooms or floating books or things like that that we're trying to fix. I mean, we could, if you want to get really, really fancy, we could say, like, oh, you have a floating book because some mod moved it? Like, oh, well, we can, like, use the engine to find a sensible place to set it down automatically. We don't have to, like, you know exactly the coordinates of where it should be. That's maybe down the line a little bit. Okay. Hey, War! So good to see you. Thank you for popping in. What is up? You know what's up. It's the same thing we do every day, Pinky. Ooh. Ooh. All right, hold up. Oh, yeah, see, I didn't, hold on. There we go. Everything makes sense again. All right. Now, take two. Bop, there we go. There we go, folks. I am extremely satisfied with that result. So what have we done here? We have just successfully implemented a way to say, let's just clean this up a little bit. If we want to really, like, code golf it up here, we can do this. We have a very succinct way. To say, yeah, we have these files that we want to, you know, nuke out of the game. Good question, Gonzo. Thank you. I mean, this is it. To answer your question directly, yes. And the framework is this. It is the YAML data that you give to the mod that we then take to do the thing that you wanted to do, right? So let's try to do another one where we move Fargoth's house. Let's try to just like awkwardly move it a little bit, yeah? Let's first get the coordinates, and then I'll randomly change like X or something by a couple units, and we'll go from there. So we'll disable for now. We'll say move. Okay, and so we're going to need X. We're just going to change X pose here. We're going to need to provide them all. But for now, let's just get in the game and get those coordinates, huh? Or can I go back up to here? Yeah, no, let's just go do that. So yeah, the intention, though, further to what Gonzo just asked, is that we have a framework that is easily updatable without being disruptive to your load order. You simply drop another data file, another YAML file in the data folder, whatever we end up naming it, and it just works. Okay. So what I'm looking for... Oh, no, that didn't actually give me what I wanted. I'm a dingus. No, yeah, it did. Here we go, XYZ. There we go. Y pose. It actually doesn't matter if I got these wrong. It would actually be more hilarious. Okay. Yes, good, okay. All right, so this code, am I a part of, thank you, Smoke a Tide Pod. Am I a part of OpenMW or am I working with it? Well, so taking a step back, OpenMW is an open source project. So really, like, you know, anybody with the chops could step up and just do it. But I have been directly involved with the project before. If you check out the release video for 0.46 or 0.47 or our April Fools from a couple of years ago, I did narration on there with my friend and buddy Atwalpa. And I contribute to the project just because I'm a fanboy, you know. So I'm like, not officially OpenMW, but I'm in spirit. Absolutely. All right. Move. We have to define move now. Almost want to just put this here. Would that work? No, that doesn't work. You can't put the result of the function in the table. I'm a dum-dum. Thank you, Gonzo. Thank you. Yeah, we all, Altariel, Gonzo, Sophie, Herdrax, the crew, we work on modding openmw.com, which is a project I began in, like, I don't know, 2016 or so. Yeah, well, so, okay, that's actually a great point. You say you're not sure how open source stuff works. It's taken a step back. It's a volunteer project. It's done by people who want to in the time that they have to do it because they want to do it, basically. And the same goes for modding openmw.com. We are an open source project. This code you're watching me do here now, this is an open source project. Everything we do as our little corner of Morrowind modding, we are open source in spirit and in ethos. Yeah. DIY. All right. Move. How do you move an object? Well, I'm glad you asked. And actually, I like the OBJ. Come on. OBJ. There we go. How do you move an object, you say? Well, the trick is to simply teleport it. Not even Todd will be any wiser. We should look, though, at how to actually do that, because I don't remember. There we go. Yeah, okay. Cell name or coords, right? Cell or name, yeah. Okay, I'm just going to put Satanine in there, and maybe that'll just work. Satanine, as named as such, is actually two, maybe three different cells, but maybe this is good enough. Okay, now comes the issue of moving it. And I feel like just changing that to 6 might be enough to get spicy. Let's see. All right. So object, but we also need going back here to the documentation. We need cell. We need a position, which is a vector 3. We're gonna have to give it a vector 3, I think. Options, but I'm not going to have any of those, I don't think. Okay. So to get a vector 3, we need to go to the util module, I think. Position is a vector 3. Yeah. That's part of the position. Actually. Which, that's a good point. So position is actually just a vector 3. Sanity check myself. I think rotation might be a teleport option, so we can omit it, and it just preserves. Yeah, here we go. Rotation. Yeah. I'm going to just back away slowly from that, because rotation is a little tricky. In a previous stream, we made the lightning rod replacer mod, and I have since realized that some of our rotation code is buggy compared to how it's supposed to work. And I don't know if that's like, could very well be a bug in our code, in our maths. Or maybe something with the rotation API in OpenMW. I've seen, and the only reason I question that is because I've seen Hernchand complain about it, and Hernchand is basically a Lua deity, a Morrowind deity, so. All right. Yes, I mean, so. Really? Did I open util? Here we go. Util. Gimme. Okay, so this is interesting. So this is actually giving us our thing here. So maybe I don't even need that. No, the position would be our new position that we're sending it to. Okay, so yes. I think this is right. And so, what will happen for disable, and we can test this, but disable only takes the first argument here, object, which we are still giving. All that other stuff is just going to be junk that's ignored, and it should just continue to work, and then we can continue to be lazy and have one function call to rule them all. All right, well, Let's just load up this data again to make sure we got move properly defined in here. Okay, move, ref num, new coordinates. Okay, will it blend? Let's see. I think now is the time to try. We should see here some awkward displacement of the building in front of us. So where exactly did I put it? The amount of units I moved it was clearly more than I expected. I guess it worked. Let's try a smaller amount. That was kind of awesome, not gonna lie. Alright, let's just change this to 98. Smaller. It's so satisfying. Atahualpa is gonna be proud of me. Just experimenting on Fargoth's house, of course. Oh my. Just too many units. Okay, let's just do fewer units. My human conception of Morrowind units is no good. So let's do fine. 73. And X will be one of these, so we should see it moving one of those ways. I think. Okay, here we go. Just... wow. Okay, now we're going to go down. I'm going to move it just one. Or actually, let's just... This is supposedly where it's supposed to be by default. It shouldn't move at all. But I bet you putting the wrong cell in there is part of it. Since we're getting it by ref ID, we could just get the cell from that. But I bet you that's the problem, because we're telling it the cell name. So it's going to one of the other Sadanines. Named Sadanine cells, I betcha. Yeah, look at that, boom. I really want to know where it went, though. I'm looking for a house on top of Fargoth somewhere. Alright. So let's fix this. Indeed, I think Sadanine is just ambiguous in the world space context, you know? So we can do it this way. We can take a cell out and simply go with the new position. So I'm not exactly sure if it's I'm not sure where it's putting the house, but it might not be putting it into the exterior world space. I'm not sure what's going on there. It warrants further investigation. What exactly am I doing here? But for now, in the interest of... And so this code won't work. Taking a step back, you're bringing up a really good point, Deltariel. Taking a step back, what I'm about to do here, just to prove the point of moving something, this isn't going to work for our concept. Smoke a Tide Pod, you're killing it with great questions. And actually, not only is such a mod possible, but it kind of exists in the form of Ashlander Architect, let's just show you this video by our good friend Zach has a cat, who is one of the modding wizards. Yeah, so check this out. Stupid. Here we go. Thank you. Okay. Check this out. This is just some mind-blowing stuff. You want to talk about, like, settlement building, kind of like what you see in Fallout 4, but maybe a little better. This is just a concept. I don't think he ever released this, but look at this. Pretty good. I'm sorry, you said build a player home. I thought you said build a castle. Oh, hey, Zach! Hey! The wizard himself is here, and yeah, there you go. It's part of the mod now. You can do this in 0.49 right now with Ashlander Architect. I'm glad to see you here, man. Nice work. Yeah, right? It's basically one of the coolest things I've ever seen, actually. I'll put the link here in the chat for you. Enjoy. And if you didn't know, you know, come to Nexus Mods and get it here. It's fantastic. All right, so back to whatever the hell it was we were doing. So we're going to need a way, before we move something, we're going to need a way to actually get, like, the cell we want to move it to. So let's take a look at the... Okay, Eltariel. riddle me this. When we're moving things, it's typically close to where it is currently. Conceivably, almost always in the current cell that it's in, right? Like, practically speaking, for the application that we're doing. Maybe we want to move, like, a stone this much, you know, right? Am I missing something? I'm going to get in-game and at least see this work. I don't know what I'm doing. Or the coordinates that I'm putting in are junk. And they're not right. So okay. Here's how we can do a better test. Smokatipod, no, would not be compatible with TES3MP. Yeah, for sure. I would love to have something like that multiplayer someday eventually. There have been some. I personally used to work on a player home mod for TES3MP way back in the day when I messed with that stuff. So I'd be surprised if such a thing didn't exist, but yeah, it would be limited compared to what Zach is doing here, right? Is that what it is? I gotta sanity check myself here. Game object. Yeah, you're very welcome. I hope you find the thing you're looking for. We're all lovers of TES3MP. Actually, our good friend Sector is a curator of a Starwind-themed TES3MP server. If you're into Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic and you didn't know about Starwind, it's a Morrowind total conversion in the KOTOR universe. Full disclosure, I do voice acting in it. It's a lovable, if not slightly janky game, but worth checking out for sure. I love Starwind. Okay, XYZ. Okay, yeah, just XYZ. I don't have a Patreon. Thank you for asking. If you go to... So do me a favor, if you're interested in that. Go to openmw.org and somewhere on here, there should be a place where you can find Patreon links for the OpenMW developers. I'm loath to tell you to go on to Discord, but if you go into the OpenMW Discord, thank you, Zach. It's on the Discord. There's a donations channel with everybody's Patreons on there, including Zach's. Go there and, yeah, help out, please, you know. Fuel the train. Okay, now. Back to this. What mad idea am I working on now? Well, so I'm just going to take the... Going back to what I asked a minute ago. Conceivably, when we're moving something, we're like moving it relative because it's in the way or something. You're welcome. Good luck. And I look forward to seeing you on Discord, too. We're just like moving something to the side because it's overlapping, right? We're not like really pushing it a lot. So I'm just going to gently nudge it. I don't know. Let's go Y this time. Y plus 10. Just to make sure I didn't like get the wrong coordinates because I'm a dumb dumb. So really having the ref num and being able to directly get the thing is super powerful. Alright. I love it. Oh, I don't know why that's so amusing, but it is. There we go. Folks, we're moving a house. Inch by inch. There we go. Okay. All right. So here we are again. I really think this is better to do. Let's say a local object. Just for readability's sake. And because we call it object here, up here, it makes it a little more clear about what's going on. And it's not a 200... column line. Wow, okay. I didn't really expect to get this far. Let's just delete that. Well, I'm going to leave that here for now. So, what do we have here? We're going to do two things here. Do I have the game open? No, okay. We're going to have Fargoth's door. I'm going to do this. Offset. Y offset will be 100. And so we're going to move the house, and we're going to disable the door. We're going to get the ref num for the door. So I'm just going to put A there for now. And we're going to have a 2-for-1 here. We're going to delete the door and move the house at once in kind of a final demonstration of how the patching process might work. You load an area, move that rock, delete that plant, boom, we're done. It looks great. No awkward conflicts, you know. And less work for us, the mod list janitors, as it were. Okay. All right. Here we go. So the door, we need to get this before it'll work. We need to actually get that ref num. Let's do that. Let's actually properly code my offset. Oh, come on. That is really hard to look at. Is what I called it. Y offset. Just for consistency. Oh, cool. Hey, Smolio. Yeah, good point. I didn't notice I got my Morrowind Park map. Hey-o. Right here. Smolio thoughtfully got me the Morrowind Park map, which you can find on Etsy. Individual goes by Nerdcraft, K-N-E-R-D, Yeah, it is pretty. It's so detailed, all the locations, and I'm just like, wow, I've never been there. I've never been there. Okay. All right. All right, so this is. We are now defining an offset in our data. We want to move 100 units to the Y. All right. And we want to delete the door, which you will note we have a distinct ref num for that compared to the house that we're moving. Okay. Is the, let's see. It's nature refuge, actually. Yeah. Extremely well done. I'm love it, and I don't have a lot of crap on the walls, but it does fit well. I've got my Fox Mulder, I Want to Believe poster right here. But that's it. I want a picture of my kitty, RIP. All right, let's get into a place here where we can see the magic happen now. Ooh. Okay. Oh, wait. What did I break? Oh, okay. Yeah, didn't like that because it didn't exist. Can I guard against that? Or maybe I have to say nil or. We'll see. So my house deleting code obviously blew up. But the door, or the house moving code blew up, but the door deleting code worked. Okay. 31 and now nil value again. Okay, fine. Let's just do this. Probably better code anyways. Get in here. There we go. Okay. What I probably let's. -200. There we go. That way it's more clear that the, because we could simply just move it, be moving the house into where the door was, and we're not seeing it get deleted. Let's push the house backwards. I wasn't aware in my brain what plus 100 would really do. Although, I guess I should know based on the grid. There we go. Wow. So, in one fell swoop, we have patched Fargot's house. I don't know about you, but I feel very accomplished. We removed the door, we pushed it back into the water a little bit, but this is kind of in a nutshell, all joking aside, how the thing is going to work. The scene's going to load, and probably it'll be like something small, like a book that you won't notice moving, or it won't have a distant kind of a thing. Yeah. Pretty cool. And so, one example of that, I think, would be, in one of the cities, there's like some big rocks that kind of overlap. When we load, the rock mod and the city mod, and they both kind of put rocks in an area that conflict, we're gonna want to disable and or move some of them, kind of in the same fashion of what I've done here, right? Like, we'll turn one rock off, we'll move the other one to the side, boom, and we have, again, just some general code here that doesn't, care too much about what it's doing, and we have it mapped to actions here, and we, the patch makers, simply say little more than, you know, what we want to do, what we want to do it to, and, you know, if so required, further details. You know, we might actually, like, also say zero, you know, see, also zero, and so forth. The final way this looks is going to definitely depend on what all we throw at it, I think, what it's useful for, but, ooh, I'm pretty happy with this, I gotta say. Cool. Comments? Questions? Let's go back to our set list here, though. So, we've mostly made the mod. Taking a look at what we have here. Let's do it now. Outside of our function, let's do it like a real world usage, right? Where we load the game and Fargoth's house gets nuked. Okay, let's try it. Let's bring back the on object active. Okay. So what we might do is we might just load this in the script body. Patch data. We'll call it patch data. This way, the patch data will be available to us the moment the mod is loaded and not reloaded every time an object is activated, because that would just be pointless. Yeah. Okay. And then we're going to do if equals. We're going to do this in a kind of a dirty way for now. Call it thing for now, but thing isn't really a good name for that. Data. And we're gonna just copy this little ditty here. And it just works because I used the same crappy variable name. Cool. And we're gonna say if if it's the thing we want, and I'm not 100% sure this is going to work. Then we would, if it's the thing we want, then we're going to do the mayhem. Okay, yeah, good. Engine. Plug it in. Fine, I'll leave that there, but we're not really gonna use this anymore. I'm just gonna leave it there for funsies. Okay. So what this means now, we're gonna run the game and Fargoth's house will be fixed. Fixed. Here we go. Prestidigitation. Here we go. Master of magic. There we go. All right. So this, what you're looking at, is going to be the future of mod patching, I think, probably. As
slick.
Yeah, right, Gonzo? Like, oof. As I was just going to say, as individuals who ourselves are making perhaps more patches than your average human, this is going to maybe increase the... or decrease, I should say, the painfulness of that process by a little bit. Of course, it's raining here, too, so this will be like a collision of mods. We'll have everybody go home while I'm talking about how good it is I'm moving Fargoth's home. Ooh, it's gonna... this will be really fun, too. We'll see Fargoth, like, walk up to his non-door and go inside. That'll be pretty good. Yeah. The default frequency, by the way, at which the mod checks weather is every 60 seconds, so it's going to take a minute for that to kick in, certainly. But what did we learn today, folks? We learned that it's possible to write some general code to do the dirty business of fixing broken stuff. And it really doesn't take that much. We just have a couple simple things we're trying to do. In addition to disable and move, we might also want to create something. Put something there. I mean, we should be able to do that as well. Absolutely. And similar to how we move and disable, we should be able to create. Going back to my game here. Woo. Oh. We don't want to miss everybody walking home here. But also swap is another interesting one too. Maybe we don't want to push Fargoth's home into the river and steal his door. Maybe we want to give him a fancier house. Maybe we want to turn his house into a boat. Maybe we want to turn his house into a guar. I mean, there's so much room for possibilities there too with just, you know, outright swapping things. But I think create, move, disable, swap are like the high-level things we may want to do there. That we do, in fact, with, again, the existing patch collection that we have. So, pretty neat. Pretty neat. Okay, so to kind of tie this together, did we... Come on, Fargoth. You can do it, my man. You know you want to. It's raining. We don't know, though, if he has, like, a random chance. Let's just take a look in the game here. We don't know if, excuse me. So there is a, here we go. Rare chance for a longer go inside delay. And he probably has been hit with that. So no big deal. You just hang out in the rain, Fargoth. It's fine. I got your ring. But you will note, by the way, everybody else is gone. Myself included. My Morrowind avatar self included. Very empty town here. Everybody went home but Fargoth, the one person I wanted to see go home. Believe it. So let's just see here. Yeah, he has not begun to go home yet. He's just chilling. I don't have an indicator in here. This is a debug info from my mod, by the way. I don't have an indicator in here that he has been given an extra long delay, but I feel like I should have that. Maybe I will add it. Anyways, way to be a buzzkill, Fargoth. All right, well, we can always just make him do it. Hold on.
Just a stick in the mud like always.
Right? This is why I pushed his house into the river, frankly. He's gotta be a bad actor, literally. So let's do rare chance to not know. And let's do
That's what it is, really. He's just tired of you messing with him.
It's not just me, man. Let's do 1 second, max delay. Just cranking all the numbers here.
Or you don't think that updating his house broke that script somehow, do you?
Nah. So, and that's a great question, though. So, go home, the mod reads coordinates data that are baked into the record of the door. So me moving it, it doesn't really matter. Okay, let's restart the game and let's see the mayhem happen again. And then we'll make Fargoth go home in the rain. And it'll be funny. Alright. So, yeah. I mean, I can already tell the house has moved a little bit. Let's just go ahead and... Give me some bad weather. And I've removed the... I put delays in the code of the mod just to make it feel less mechanical, right? Like, you're not going to see the same exact patterns every single night, most likely. In my experience, it's been pretty cool. But for the testing purposes now, it's a little annoying, so we just ticked all that off. And there goes Vadius. Go home, you. Boop. Come on, Fargoth. You can do it, buddy. There you go. Wait. You kidding me? Wow. Oh, wait, you know what I didn't see? Bad weather, true. Okay, yeah, he should be going home any minute, I swear. Everybody else did. Including my favorite test NPC, Eldifier. She's gone. And one interesting thing, too, while we're waiting for Fargoth to get with the program here. Wait. Where did he go? Anyways, one of the neat things we can do here is let's go ahead and unlock the door and go inside. Whoops. Unlock the door and we can pop inside and we actually will find Eldifier here inside her house. And that's one of the things Go Home does, and it's one of the reasons why we read the doors. We find out if it's supposed to be their home, and then are there coordinates inside where we could reasonably put the person in question here. And so if we just do this. And, you know, now she's inside using her default AI state. yeah, exactly. Well, so that, right, go away. I love that. I didn't think of that name, but that's an appropriate, you know, thematic name for the feature of the door knocking that we talked about before, right? The bigger question I have right now is, where the hell is Fargoth? We can always check inside his house, though. Let's see. Son of a gun. Well, he's not here. Oh, interesting. It did a, hey. So it did a line of sight disable on Fargoth instead of sending him home. Interesting. Okay. So that might be to a recent change I made to being more conservative with touching NPCs who don't wander. But that's a mistake. Fargoth should go home. But we also have here, I should note, the disabled for quest field, and that just means, for example, when you're waiting up on the lighthouse, spoiler alert, Fargoth isn't going to be going home when you need him to be out. Yeah, I wonder why he failed the test, though. Let's see here. Hold on. Actor has no door. Fargoth. Huh. Has no door. Okay. Interesting. Why does that be, though? Why is that be? Whatever. Oh, Eltariel. Welcome back. You got to see it. It's yes. The answer is yes. So let me just, before I show you what we have ended up with, let me show you the code. Just because you might be interested in how succinct it is. Global. Give me this one. So this is our code in its entirety. We have implemented disable and move. And it's placed in on object active, right? Behold. And we're about ready to call it quits here. But this is a good place to end up. If you weren't hyped for OpenMW 0.49, I mean, boom, right here. That's how you... We got the house moved. And the door deleted. There you go. So, the future of patching... Yeah, right? So basically the future of patching is going to look, unfortunately, like this. I mean, YAML is what it is, but at the same time, this is a little bit better than going in there and being like, oh, yeah, here's a new plugin, install it, you know? All right, very cool. So what did we do today? We did a sound check. Gonzo and I chatted a little bit about some of the updates on the website that came out. I showed y'all just some of the new stuff we've been up to, and then we made a Lua mod. We, from scratch, wrote the Lua fixer, which is what we were just looking at here, and that's going to be, again, the future of patching, really. We can dynamically, with a succinct amount of Lua code, fix the game on the fly. So, anything you want to add to that, Gonzo? I think we're going to call it quits for today.
That's all I got.
Excellent. All right. Well, then, thank you, everybody in the stream, for joining today. We'll try to get back at you soon. This has been the MOMW Show, and I wish you a good day and happy modding. Cheers, everybody.